President Trump siding with the Saudi government again. He continues to cast doubt on the CIA's findings about the murder of journalist Jamal Khashoggi, while arguing that Saudi money flowing into the United States is important not to lose. Instead of placing any blame on the Crown Prince, he and his Secretary of State are blaming what they describe as a dark and vicious world.
It's a mean, nasty world out there. The Middle East in particular.
You take a look at what's going on in Iran and the vicious situation that's taking place there and the number of people that are being killed and slaughtered. You take a look all over the world. We're not going to be able to deal with, let's not deal with anybody. Maybe the world should be held accountable because the world is a vicious place. World is a very, very vicious place. You look at what's happening in China, and you look at what's happening in so many different countries. I could name many countries. You look at what's happening with terrorism all over the world.
Karen Attiah is with me. She's a global opinions editor for The Washington Post, and it was Karen who recruited Khashoggi to the Post about a year ago. So, Karen, always a pleasure to have you on, and I just wanted you to react to the president, saying it was it's the world, this vicious world, to blame for Jamal's murder. What do you make of that?
It's just such a, you know, for a president and an administration that has been so preoccupied with projecting strength, with projecting America first. It just is such a sort of weak and cynical statement, and it denotes a sort of helplessness in the face of human rights abuses, of repression. And says nothing of, you know, our role in, at least in this case, in the case of Jamal's murder, in the case of the war in Yemen, in the case of you know, what we're seeing to be, you know, a global instability and repression coming from Saudi Arabia, denying that we have any sort of role to play in stopping this. And it just makes us look helpless. And that is not the case. We are not, as the United States of America and as a country that Saudi Arabia depends very much on for its economy and its survival.
The statement that the president released a couple of days ago, I haven't spoken with you since he released a statement siding with the Saudis, you know, the line, maybe he did, maybe he didn't, referring to MBS. Of the whole thing, what was most unsettling to you when you first read it?
I mean, beyond the fact that, you know, as far as a statement goes, it was written as if it was penned by, you know, a middle schooler, not the president of the United States. I think it just, beyond smearing Jamal as some sort of enemy of the state of Saudi Arabia, which he wasn't, I think what was most disturbing about that is, first of all, nobody is claiming that we want to break relations with Saudi Arabia. The problem isn't so much that, it's the issue of Mohammed bin Salman and the questioning our relationship with a man who, you know, not only most likely ordered the butchering of a Washington Post writer, but also has been the main architect of a vicious war in Yemen, who has kidnapped the prime minister of Lebanon, who has broken off diplomatic relations with Canada and really and truly doesn't deserve this unconditional support from the Trump administration that he seems to be enjoying. I mean, what can we point to as far as, you know, his rise 3 years ago from deputy crown prince to crown prince now? There's nothing really that we can point to as far as any developments that have really ensured the stability of the Middle East and of his country. So I think it made us look like a servant of Saudi Arabia, not a partner.
A servant. And there are people who do want to push further. I want to hold you over a commercial break, Karen. I want to ask you about the Democrats now looking to investigate specifically the president's financial ties to Saudi Arabia. Back in just a moment. Continuing my conversation with Karen Attiah, global opinions editor for The Washington Post. And Karen, what I wanted to ask you, too, is about how the soon-to-be chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, Adam Schiff, he told your paper that Democrats will indeed investigate the president's personal financial dealings with Saudi Arabia. Financial. Do you think that that could explain the president's response in all of this?
I mean, I think this is absolutely something that we need to look into. Because the president's response, again, is bordering on the irrational at this point, considering, you know, what our own intelligence agency has concluded. Again, not guessed, not any sort of feelings. This is with high confidence. And in addition to the CIA's findings, we also know that intelligence from other countries, Germany, UK, also have similar intelligence as far as the, again, viciousness of Mohammed bin Salman and in relation to this murder. So, you know, it's welcome and it's absolutely necessary, because I think what we need to underscore in this case is that if we allow, you know, our administration to turn a blind eye, and whether or not that's because of financial interests or not, we're in a situation where a lot of people's lives are in absolute danger. We can't allow for a blank check to be given to ruthless leaders who are just willing to silence anybody and anybody at any time, at any place. So I think Adam Schiff, it's we need to send a message to the administration as well, that if there are conflicts of interest, financial conflicts of interest that are putting money basically before lives, that needs to come to light, and that needs to end.
Yeah, another piece of this, Jason Rezaian was on with me earlier this week, mm-hmm. Jason Rezaian of the Washington Post. He told me that he feels a lot less safe working as a journalist in the U.S. right now. Here he was.
As a journalist who has unfortunately experienced some of that in the world, I feel a lot less safe today working in the United States of America than I did a couple of hours ago. And I think this is a horrible message to be sending to the world, really kind of condoning this murder only in the interests of our commercial dealings with Saudi Arabia.
I was just wondering, Karen, if you feel the same way and why.
I agree with Jason. I also feel less safe. I'm more concerned with those who I work with who are from, you know, these regimes, who have been telling me for the last 6 weeks since Jamal's murder that they are terrified for their lives. They are terrified that they could be taken out. If somebody as prominent as Jamal can just be taken out of the picture in such a gruesome way, that they feel that nobody will stand up to them and nobody will check any of these leaders. And so I think that is what's at stake here. That is, it's beyond Jamal at this point. It's about whether or not we are willing to say enough is enough, and journalist lives matter, Arab lives matter, free expression matters. And this has been such Jamal felt safe. I think Jamal felt safe in the United States working for the Washington Post. And I think we also thought that that would be something that would protect him. And the idea that it didn't is chilling. And so, you know, but we have a chance. I don't want us to feel helpless. And I think the Democrats have a massive role to play, principled Republicans, people, American citizens, to press on us to get to the bottom of this and to impose consequences on those who did this, because lives are on the line. People are being killed.
Democrats, as you say, right. and Republicans, keep speaking up, Karen. Keep using your voice. Karen Attiah over at the Washington Post, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.